Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Genealogies of Religion, Discipline and Reasons of Power in Christianity and Islam, by Talal Asad, narrated by Amir Abdullah. Introduction. The essays brought together in this volume deal with historical topics that vary in time and place, ranging from the rites of medieval European monks to the sermons of contemporary Arab theologians. What links them all together is the assumption that Western history has had an overriding importance, for good or ill, in the making of the modern world, and that explorations of that history should be a major anthropological concern. It has sometimes been noted that peoples from non-Western countries feel obliged to learn the history of the West, but not each other's histories, and that Westerners, in turn, do not feel the same need to study non-Western histories. The history of modern Western thought, for example, can be, and is, written on its own, but not so the history of contemporary Arab thought. One opposition between the West and the non-West, and so a mode of connection between them, is constructed historically by these asymmetrical desires and indifferences. My anthropological explorations into Christian and post-Christian history are therefore motivated by the conviction that its conceptual geology has profound implications for the ways in which non-Western traditions are now able to grow and change. More particularly, I hold that anthropologists who would study, say, Muslim beliefs and practices will need some understanding of how religion has come to be formed as concept and practice in the modern West. For while religion is integral to modern Western history, there are dangers in employing it as a normalizing concept when translating Islamic traditions. The genealogy of religion is a central theme in my essays. Thus, chapters 1 and 2 sketch the emergence of religion as a modern historical object. In the next two chapters, I approach the problem obliquely, by discussing in turn two elements in medieval Christianity that are no longer generally accepted by modern religion: the productive role of physical pain and the virtue of self-abasement. From the point of view of theological modernism, as well as of secular morality, they are both archaic, uncivilized conditions. Chapters 5 and 6 address aspects of the asymmetry between Western and non-Western histories. The former deals with problems of anthropological translation, the latter with the limitations of a non-Christian religious tradition when juxtaposed with the Enlightenment doctrine of critical reason. They deal with translation in a double sense, interpreting from one language into another and conveying sacred relics from one shrine to another. The two final chapters, 7 and 8, were written at the height of the so-called Rushdie affair, in response to the angry positions then taken up in the name of liberalism about religious intolerance. All the chapters thus deal with fragments of the West's religious history, because I assume that the West's definition of itself, and therefore its engagement with non-Western cultures, includes that history. Among anthropologists, history is a notion that few would now dare to despise. On the contrary, all of us solemnly acknowledge it. But what kind of history? More often than not, it is history in the active voice. Everywhere, local people are making their own history, contesting it, borrowing meanings from Western dominators, and reconstructing their own cultural existence. This notion of history emphasizes not only the unceasing work of human creators, but also the unstable and hybrid character of their creation. In some versions, therefore, the determining character of world system and dependent structure is rejected. In others, what is repudiated are claims about authenticity, a different people, a unitary culture, tradition, and so on. Intelligent and influential people writing today are committed to this view of history making. Nevertheless, I remain skeptical. So I shall begin by rehearsing briefly what I find to be unconvincing about it, and at the same time sketch, through a process of resistance, alternative conceptions that orient the following chapters, even though most of these conceptions are not treated explicitly in them. Early in his recent Radcliffe-Brown lecture, Marshall Solins declared his intention to join the anthropological chorus of protest against the idea that the global expansion of Western capitalism, or the world system, so-called, has made the colonized and peripheral peoples the passive objects of their own history, and not its authors, and through tributary economic relations has turned their cultures likewise into adulterated goods. Solens proceeds to chide Eric Wolff for reducing the histories of non-European peoples to the history of global capitalism, despite Wolff's proclaimed wish to make non-Europeans the authors of their own history. The trouble with Wolff, Solens tells us, is his attachment to economistic Marxism. If only we had a more sophisticated Marxist understanding of production as a cultural process, we would at once see the falsity of assuming that the world expansion of capitalism brings all other cultural history to an end. Solens's histories of the British opening up of Imperial China, the European commercial penetration into Hawaii, and the Kwakiutl appropriation of European goods are intended to show how each encounter was guided by the cultural logic of the local people concerned. Solens's narratives are learned and persuasive. Although a rigorous Marxist might want to point out that he draws his examples from the early phases of European expansion, which makes it easier to identify capitalism with exchange and consumption rather than with the transformation of production and the reorganization of power relations. I have no wish to defend economistic Marxism here, or Wolff for that matter. What worries me is that the arguments espoused by this anthropological chorus, now joined by a chorus of historians, are not as clear as they might be. Thus, when Solens protests that local peoples are not passive objects of their own history, it should be evident that this is not equivalent to claiming that they are its authors. The sense of author is ambiguous as between the person who produces a narrative and the person who authorizes particular powers, including the right to produce certain kinds of narrative. The two are clearly connected, but there is an obvious sense in which the author of a biography is different from the author of the life that is its object, even if it is true that as an individual, as an active subject, that person is not entirely the author of his own life. Indeed, since everyone is in some degree or other an object for other people, as well as an object of others' narratives, no one is ever entirely the author of her life. People are never only active agents and subjects in their own history. The interesting question in each case is, in what degree and in what way are they agents or patients? Western capitalism, Solens observes, has loosed on the world enormous forces of production, coercion, and destruction. Yet precisely because they cannot be resisted, the relations and goods of the larger system also take on meaningful places in local schemes of things. If that is so, then local peoples have to be seen in a crucial sense as the passive objects of their own history and not its authors. Their authorship consists merely in adjusting consciously to those forces and giving that adjustment a meaning. But in that sense, they are no different from local peoples in Western societies from whom the relations and goods of the larger system also take on meaningful places in the local scheme of things. To take an extreme example, even the inmates of a concentration camp are able, in this sense, to live by their own cultural logic. But one may be forgiven for doubting that they are, therefore, making their own history. To the extent that what Solens calls the larger system determines the conditions within which things take on meaningful places, all peoples can be said to be the passive objects of their own history and not its authors. And that is precisely what Solens sometimes seems to be saying. Not to suggest, then, that we ignore the modern juggernaut, only that its historical course be viewed as a cultural process. But why essentially as a cultural process? One could put it this way, perhaps. The main storyline is authored by the capitalist juggernaut, and local peoples provide their own interpretations in local performances. Yet, even here, we are offered the thought that world capitalism is the primary agent, local peoples, at best, the secondary ones. In a widely read review article on contemporary anthropological theory, which must be included in the anthropological course Solins alludes to, Sherry Ortner has written feelingly against this very view. Whether it be the hidden hand of structure or the juggernaut of capitalism that is seen as the agent of society slash history, it is certainly not in any central way real people doing real things. Her suggestion seems to be that Western capitalism is an abstraction, a mere fiction, to be signaled by quaint metaphors or ironic quotation marks, which does not, therefore, determine the lives of real people doing real things. This theoretical objection is not Ortner's only complaint, nor is it always compatible with others she makes. Specifically, she says at one point, I find the capitalism-centered view of the world questionable, to say the least, especially for anthropology. We should not assume, she goes on, either that everything anthropologists encounter in the field must already have been affected by the capitalist world system, or that everything is best explained as a response to the latter. Now, this in itself is an empirical point about the extent of capitalist influence throughout the world, but it is based on the assumption that world capitalism exists and that its effects can be confirmed or denied in the places where anthropologists work. It therefore also presupposes the theoretical problem of identifying world capitalism, whether as something prior to or as inclusive of its local effects. It suggests, especially for anthropology, that some theoretical idea of world capitalism is necessary if its historical consequences are to be recognized. There is, however, yet another sense of disquiet that Ortner has about the capitalism-centered worldview, this time related to the special role that a fieldwork-defined anthropology can play in the academy, a site that it shares with other human sciences. The attempt to view other systems from ground level is the basis, perhaps the only basis, of anthropology's distinctive contribution to the human sciences. It is our capacity, largely developed in fieldwork, to take the perspective of the folks among whom we research, that allows us to learn anything at all, even in our own culture, beyond what we already know. It is our location on the ground that puts us in a position to see people not simply as passive reactors to and enactors of some system, but as active agents and subjects in their own history. The ethnographer may come from another system, say, a major capitalist country, but her task is to observe and describe the practices of people on the ground, not to intervene in what she sees. For Ortner, there is, therefore, a sense in which anthropology's viewpoint is complementary to that of the sciences that study world capitalism, since it directs the attention of researchers at a different level of other systems. However, if anthropology's distinctive contribution requires it to take a ground-level view of things, it is difficult to see how confining oneself to that level is sufficient to determine in what degree and in what way other levels become relevant. The difficulty with this kind of talk is that it employs two different images simultaneously, one having to do with real people, which implies that systems are unreal, and the other with ground level, which concedes that there are other levels but claims that the latter are dependent on the former, rather than the other way around. The two images are then used to define the theoretical autonomy as well as the distinctive contribution of fieldwork-based anthropology. The fact is that all the human sciences deal with real people. Even psychiatry deals with real people thinking slash feeling unreal things. It is an old empiricist prejudice to suppose that things are real only when confirmed by sensory data, and that therefore people are real, but structures and systems aren't. There are systematic features of human collectivities that are real enough, even though you can't see them directly. For example, life expectancies, crime ratios, voting patterns, and rates of productivity. You can see them once they are represented as tables, graphs, and maps on a sheet of paper or a computer screen. Here, seeing and manipulating are closely connected. Various kinds of social practice are inconceivable without such representations. Governments, businesses, churches, and other social bodies in the contemporary world cannot do without them, even in places as peripheral as Papua New Guinea. But note that the issue here is not whether a local culture is pure or derivative, unitary or contested, nor is it being proposed that there is a supercausality, the historical law of capitalism, that determines how everybody on the ground must live. I am concerned with how systematicity, including the kind that is essential to what is called capitalism, is apprehended, represented, and used in the contemporary world. When quantitative data relating to a local population are aggregated, analyzed, and manipulated, the results can be used to inform particular kinds of systematic practice directed at that population. The representation of the data also becomes essential to a distinctive style of argument by which such practices are justified or criticized. The system with which I am concerned here therefore relates to a mode of human agency, real people doing real things, one that conditions other people's lives. The immediate objective of this agency, however, is not to cause individual actors to behave in one way rather than another. It is to change aggregate human conditions, distributions, trends, etc., that are profitable or useful in, for example, matters of landed property, disease, and literacy. Its systematicity lies, therefore, in probabilities, not causalities, but it is a kind of systematicity, and therefore of power, that is not easily grasped through what is typified as anthropological fieldwork. For although it represents people and their activities at ground level, it does not mirror them. In fairness, it should be said that Ortner may not really subscribe to the empiricist prejudice I have adverted to, in spite of the language she uses. Probably all she wants to say, somewhat like Solon's, is that world capitalism has not homogenized the cultures of local peoples. And that, I repeat, is prima facie, a reasonable claim, although it doesn't tell us whether, and if so, how local peoples make their own history. The term local peoples, now increasingly used by ethnographers instead of the older primitive, tribal, simple, preliterate, and so on, can be misleading in an interesting way and calls for some unpacking. In a literal sense, of course, all people most of the time are local in the sense of being locatable, since anthropologists now generally claim that their distinctiveness rests on a method, fieldwork, rather than an object, non-European cultures. This sense recommends itself to them. Fieldwork defines privileged access to the local, yet not everyone who is local in this sense has the same opportunity for movement or the same practical reach. National politicians in the Sudanese capital and nomads and peasants in the provinces, corporation directors in an Australian metropolis and mine workers in the New Guinean highlands, generals in the Pentagon and frontline soldiers in the Gulf, and so on. They are all locatable, but not equally so by each other. To say of people that they are local is to imply that they are attached to a place, rooted, circumscribed, limited. People who are not local are thought of either as displaced, uprooted, disoriented, or more positively as unlimited, cosmopolitan, universal, belonging to the whole world, and the world belonging to them. Thus, Saudi theologians, who invoke the authority of medieval Islamic texts, are taken to be local. Western writers, who invoke the authority of modern secular literature, claim they are universal. Yet both are located in universes that have rules of inclusion and exclusion. Immigrants who arrive from South Asia to settle in Britain are described as uprooted. English officials who lived in British India were not. An obvious difference between them is power. The former become subjects of the crown, the latter its representatives. What are the discursive definitions of authorized space? Everyone can relate themselves or is allocated to a multiplicity of spaces, phenomenal and conceptual, whose extensions are variously defined and whose limits are variously imposed, transgressed, and reset. Modern capitalist enterprises and modernizing nation-states are the two most important powers that organize spaces today, defining, among other things, what is local and what is not. Being locatable, local peoples are those who can be observed, reached, and manipulated as and when required. Knowledge about local peoples is not itself local knowledge, as some anthropologists have thought. Nor is it therefore simply universal in the sense of being accessible to everyone. Anthropologists, such as Solins and Ortner, assume that the thesis of agency and creativity in the non-European world requires that the idea of cultural autonomy be defended. More recently, a very different argument has been advanced for that thesis. Among anthropologists, James Clifford is its most eloquent exponent. This century has seen a drastic expansion of mobility, including tourism, migrant labor, immigration, urban sprawl. More and more people dwell with the help of mass transit, automobiles, airplanes. In cities on six continents, foreign populations have come to stay, mixing in, but often in partial, specific fashions. The exotic is uncannily close. Conversely, there seem no distant places left on the planet where the presence of modern products, media, and power cannot be felt. An older topography and experience of travel is exploded. One no longer leaves home confident of finding something radically new, another time or space. Difference is encountered in the adjoining neighborhood. The familiar turns up at the ends of the earth. Cultural difference is no longer a stable, exotic otherness. Self-other relations are matters of power and rhetoric, rather than of essence. A whole structure of expectations about authenticity in culture and in art is thrown in doubt. In this vision of a fractured, fluid world, all human beings live in the same cultural predicament. There is no single privileged narrative of the modern world, and therefore the history of global capitalism is rejected. Everyone is dislocated. No one is rooted. Because there is no such thing as authenticity, borrowing and copying do not signify a lack. On the contrary, they indicate libidinal energies and creative human agency. For everyone, Clifford insists, cultural identity is mixed, relational, inventive. Not all listeners will find such representations of modern history, of which there are many within as well as outside anthropology, acceptable. What is striking, however, is the cheerfulness with which this predicament of culture is proffered. Indeed, in spite of frequent references to unequal power, which is explored only in the context of fieldwork and ethnography, we are invited to celebrate the widening scope of human agency that geographical and psychological mobility now afford. Hannah Arendt had a very different response to mobility in her famous analysis of European totalitarianism, first published in the 1950s. There she spoke of uprootedness and superfluousness, which have been the curse of modern masses since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution and have become acute with the rise of imperialism at the end of the last century and the breakdown of political institutions and social traditions in our own time. Arendt's sense of deep pessimism may be put down to someone who had herself experienced the horrors of Nazism, and her analysis of totalitarianism may be criticized for some oversimplifications. She is nevertheless aware of a problem that has escaped the serious attention of those who would have us celebrate human agency and the decentered subject. The problem of understanding how dominant power realizes itself through the very discourse of mobility. For Arendt is very clear that mobility is not merely an event in itself, but a moment in the subsumption of one act by another. If people are physically and morally uprooted, they are more easily moved. And when they are easy to move, they are more easily rendered physically and morally superfluous. From the point of view of power, mobility is a convenient feature of the act subsumed, but a necessary one of the subsuming act. For it is by means of geographical and psychological movement that modern power inserts itself into pre-existing structures, That process is necessary to defining existing identities and motives as superfluous, and to constructing others in their place. Meanings are thus not only created, they are also redirected or subverted, as so many novels about indigenous life in the colonies have poignantly depicted. The positive connection between mobility and modernity is fairly well established in sociological literature. I take one instructive example. In 1958, Daniel Lerner published an academic bestseller on modernization in the Middle East entitled The Passing of Traditional Society. Its thesis was that modernity in the West had depended principally on the mobile personality, that is, on a type of person eager to move, to change, and to invent. Empathy was said to be central to that personality, and Lerner defined it as the capacity to see oneself in the other fellow's situation. Only the mobile personality, he contended, was able to relate creatively to the modern condition. Many of us in the Middle East studies criticized it in the 1960s and 1970s for its inadequate scholarship and careless methodology. However, the most illuminating engagement with that book was undertaken in 1980 by a student of 16th century English literature. In chapter 6 of his Renaissance Self-Fashioning, Stephen Greenblatt developed the brilliant insight that what Professor Lerner calls empathy, Shakespeare calls Iago. He proposed that the idea shared by Lerner's empathy and Shakespeare's Iago was improvisation, the ability both to capitalize on the unforeseen and to transform given materials into one's own scenario. I quote in full. The spur-of-the-moment quality of improvisation is not as critical here as the opportunistic grasp of that which seems fixed and established. Indeed, as Castiglione and others in the Renaissance well understood, the impromptu character of an improvisation is itself often a calculated mask, the product of careful preparation. Conversely, all plots, literal and behavioral, inevitably have their origin in a moment prior to formal coherence, a moment of experimental, aleatory impulse, in which the available, received materials are curved toward a novel shape. We cannot locate a point of pure premeditation or pure randomness. What is essential is the Europeans' ability again and again to insinuate themselves into the pre-existing political, religious, even psychic structures of the natives, and to turn those structures to their advantage. Professor Lerner is right to insist that this ability is a characteristically, though not exclusively, Western mode. Present to varying degrees in the classical and medieval world, and greatly strengthened from the Renaissance onward, he misleads only in insisting further that it is an act of imaginative generosity, a sympathetic appreciation of the situation of the other fellow. For when he speaks confidently of the spread of empathy around the world, we must understand that he is speaking of the exercise of Western power, power that is creative as well as destructive, but that is scarcely ever wholly disinterested or benign. The point I want to draw out from this perceptive account of Western power relates not to the moral status of its intentions, but to its transforming work. In any case, the European wish to make the world in its own image is not necessarily to be disparaged as ungenerous. If one believes oneself to be the source of salvation, the wish to make others reflect oneself is not unbenign, however terrible the practices by which this desire is put into effect. Besides, in a tradition that connects pain with achievement, the inflicting of suffering on others is not in itself reprehensible. It is to be condemned only when it is gratuitous, where the pain as means is out of proportion to an objective end. Hence, the subjective enjoyment of pain is regarded as both immoral and pathological. But the question I want to raise here is this. To the extent that such power seeks to normalize other people's motivations, whose history is being made? Note that my question is not about the authenticity of individual agency, but about the structure of normal personhood, normal in both the statistical and the medical sense. and the techniques for securing it. I ask whether improvisation becomes irrelevant when the agents are non-Europeans acting within the context of their own politically independent state to implement a European project. The continuous physical and moral improvement of an entire governable population through flexible strategies. Whose improvised story do these agents construct? Who is its author, and who is its subject? The idea that cultural borrowing must lead to total homogeneity and to loss of authenticity is culturally absurd. But the idea of projects having translatable historical structures should not be confused with it. When a project is translated from one site to another, from one agent to another, versions of power are produced. As with translations of a text, one does not simply get a reproduction of identity. The acquisition of new forms of language from the modern West, whether by forcible imposition, insidious insertion, or voluntary borrowing, is part of what makes for new possibilities of action in non-Western societies. Yet although the outcome of these possibilities is never fully predictable, the language in which the possibilities are formulated is increasingly shared by Western and non-Western societies, and so too, the specific forms of power and subjection. Choices and desires make actions before actions can make history, but predefined social relations and language forms, as well as the body's materiality, shape the person to whom normal desires and choices can be attributed. That is why questions about what it is possible for agents to do must also address the process by which normal persons are constituted. Meanings are never simply generated by a cultural logic. They belong variously to conventional projects, occasional intentions, natural events, and so on. For theologians such as Augustine and Al-Ghazali, they also relate to all-encompassing divine purposes. The medieval Christian monk, who learns to make the abbot's will into his own, learns thereby to desire God's purposes. In an important sense, the meaning of his actions is what it is by virtue of their being part of a transcendent project. And so, too, the actions of all agents are part of transcendent temporal structures. The fact that the further significance of actions becomes apparent only when a certain time has elapsed is one to which working historians are likely to be more sensitive than working ethnographers. Even among non-believers, few would claim that the human agent is sovereign, although post-Enlightenment moral theory insists that she ought to be autonomous. This theory has long been criticized by conservative as well as socialist writers. Moral considerations apart, it is evident that the increasingly sophisticated division of labor and the consumer culture of modern capitalism renders individual autonomy less and less feasible as a practical possibility. More recently, some radical critics, particularly those concerned with third world studies, have drawn on post-structuralist ideas to attack the Enlightenment idea of autonomy. A thoughtful example is the Indianist Rosalind O'Hanlon, who questions the liberal humanist notions of subjectivity and agency in a review of the work of the Subaltern Studies Group of historians. The starting point for the latter was their dissatisfaction with the elite historiography of India, which denied subordinate peoples a consciousness of their own, and hence the capacity to make their own history. Orientalist and functionalist anthropologies of India were also condemned for their alleged essentialism. Note the first assumption of the history-making thesis, that history is not made unless significant change occurs. It is not sufficient for events to succeed one another. Something substantial must be transformed. O'Hanlon sympathizes with the subaltern historians' wish to recover suppressed histories, but points to the theoretical danger such an agenda conceals of slipping into essentialist humanism. One must reject, she says, the myth of the self-constituting subject, that a consciousness or being which has an origin outside itself is no being at all. From such a rejection, we can proceed to the idea that though histories and identities are necessarily constructed and produced from many fragments which do not contain the signs of any essential belonging inscribed in them. This does not cause the history of the subaltern to dissolve once more into invisibility. This is firstly because we apply exactly the same decentering strategies to the monolithic subject agents of elite historiography, and second, because it is the creative practice of the subaltern which now becomes the focus of our attention, his ability to appropriate and mold cultural materials of almost any provenance to his own purposes, and to discard those which no longer serve them. O'Hanlon's criticism reaches its target, although occasionally at the cost of reproducing the ambiguity in the different senses of authoring that I touched on earlier. Thus, to decenter subject agents of elite historiography is not at all identical with subverting people in positions of governmental authority. The idea of self-constitution is not merely a historiographical option, but a liberal humanist principle that has far-reaching moral, legal, and political implications in modern/modernizing states. That is why we find O'Hanlon, as a progressivist, obliged to reintroduce the principle in order to authenticate the subaltern subject. For how else could the subaltern's authentic purposes, his own purposes, be distinguished from those of his masters, if not through the struggle for self-constitution? Note the second assumption of the history-making thesis, that an agent cannot make his own history unless he is autonomous. It is not enough that he acts purposively. His purposes must be in conflict with others. The essence of the principle of self-constitution is consciousness. That is, a metaphysical concept of consciousness is essential for explaining how the many fragments come to be constructed as parts of a single self-identifying subject. Yet, if we set aside the Hegelian concept of consciousness, the teleological principle is starting from sense certainty and culminating in reason, and the Kantian concept of the transcendental subject, which Hegel rewrote as consciousness, it will have to be admitted that consciousness in the everyday psychological sense, awareness, intent, and the giving of meaning to experiences, is inadequate to account for agency. One does not have to subscribe to a full-blown Freudianism to see that instinctive reaction, the docile body, and the unconscious work in their different ways more pervasively and continuously than consciousness does. This is part of the reason why an agent's act is more and less than her consciousness of it. Another part has to do with the subsumability of her acts into the projects of other agents. Beyond a certain point, an act no longer belongs exclusively to its initiator. It is precisely because this fact is overlooked that the historical importance of consciousness is exaggerated in the literature that takes consent and repression to be the two basic conditions of political domination. For to explain the latter in terms of these conditions, whether singly or in combination, is to resort to explanation exclusively in terms of consciousness. It is consequently to ignore the politically more significant condition that has to do with the objective distribution of goods that allows or precludes certain options. The structures of possible actions that are included and excluded are therefore logically independent of the consciousness of actors. Another way of putting this is to say that the systematic knowledge, for example, statistical information, on which an agent must draw in order to act in ways that make history, is not subjective in any sense. It does not imply the self. The subject, on the other hand, is founded on consciousness of self. My argument, in brief, is that contrary to the discourse of many radical historians and anthropologists, agent and subject, where the former is the principle of effectivity and the latter of consciousness, do not belong to the same theoretical universe and should not, therefore, be coupled. John Prakash is a talented subalternist who appears to have read and approved of O'Hanlon's critique. In an invigorating essay on post-Orientalist historiography of India, he argues for a more radical post-structuralist position intended to supersede conventional ethnography and historiography. Anthropologists drawn to the idea of real people making their own history, will want to read this provocative piece because it exposes metaphysical traces in historical narration that, he argues, reproduce the capitalist-centered view of the world. Prakash is against foundational history, by which he means two things. One, a history whose subject, individual, class, or structure, is taken to be irreducible, and two, teleological history. For example, a historical narrative of aborted, delayed, or distorted capitalism. Foundationalism in these two forms is rejected in order to widen the space for excluded histories. While narrative history does not have to be teleological, it does presuppose an identity, India say, that is the subject of that narrative. Even when that identity is analyzed into its heterogeneous parts, class, gender, regional divisions, etc., what is done, surely, is to reveal its constitution, not to dissolve its unity. The unity is maintained by those who speak in its name, and more generally, by all who adjust their existence to its sometimes shifting requirements. The claim of many radical critics that hegemonic power necessarily suppresses difference in favor of unity is quite mistaken. Just as mistaken is their claim that that power always abhors ambiguity. To secure its unity, to make its own history, dominant power has worked best through differentiating and classifying practices. India's colonial history furnishes ample evidence of this. In this context, power is constructive, not repressive. Furthermore, its ability to select or construct the differences that serve its purposes has depended on its exploiting the dangers and opportunities contained in ambiguous situations. And ambiguity, as we heard in Greenblatt's example, is precisely one of the things that gives Western power its improvisational quality. By a curious irony, Prakash's rejection of the modernization narrative on the grounds that it is teleological indirectly reveals something about the sense of the phrase making one's own history, which many anthropologists also employ. For while the expression indicates a disapproval of historical narratives of the non-West in which Europe is too prominent, as actor or as norm, it also conceals a concept of history-making that is parasitic on those very narratives. If the modernizing project is more than merely an accumulating narrative of India's past, if we understand it as the project of constructing India, an integrated totality defined according to progressive principles, which requires the continuous calculation of India's future, then teleology is precisely what that project must reflect. A project is, after all, by definition, teleological. The career of the Indian nation-state is itself part of that project. To say this is to say something not merely about those who ruled India in the effort to change it in a particular direction, but also about those who struggled against them. The struggle is carried out, more often than not, in a new language initiated by European enlightenment. Liberty, equality, reason, progress, human rights, and so forth. And, more importantly, within new political legal spaces built up under British colonialism. To recount the career of the Indian nation-state is to try to understand how and why the modernization project succeeds or fails in particular times and places, and how it constructs and redefines itself as a project. And hence, to re-describe it in terms that its supporters would reject, but it must be understood as a teleology, whose desired future, in important respects, is foreshadowed in the present of Western liberal capitalist states. It does not follow that the project is driven by law-like forces, that its ultimate success is inevitable, or that it cannot be reformulated. However, to those who have been taught to regard essentialism as the gravest of intellectual sins, it is necessary to explain that certain things are essential to that project, as indeed there are to India as a nation-state. To say this is not equivalent to saying that the project, or India, can never be changed. It is to say that each historical phenomenon is determined by the way it is constituted, that some of its constitutive elements are essential to its historical identity, and some are not. It is like saying that the constitutive rules of a game define its essence, which is by no means to assert that the game can never be subverted or changed. It is merely to point to what determines its essential historical identity, to imply that certain changes, though not others, will mean that the game is no longer the same game. The project of modernization, westernization, including its aim of material and moral progress, is certainly a matter of history making. But it is a project whose innumerable agents are neither fully autonomous nor fully conscious of it. Indeed, in a crucial sense, it is that project, inaugurated in Europe over two centuries ago, that articulates our concept of human beings making history. For that project was intertwined with a new experience of historical time, and thus with a novel conception of historicity. Historical time divided into three great periods: antiquity, the Middle Ages, and modernity, accelerating forward into an open future. The West defines itself, in opposition to all non-Western cultures, by its modern historicity. Despite the disjunctions of modernity, its break with tradition, the West therefore includes within itself its past as an organic continuity. From the Greeks and Romans, and the Hebrews and early Christians, through Latin Christendom, the Renaissance, and the Reformation, to the universal civilization of modern Europeans. Although it is spatially discontinuous and internally diverse, the West is not a mere Hegelian myth, not a mere representation ready to be unmasked by a handful of talented critics. For good or ill, it informs innumerable intentions, practices, and discourses in systematic ways. This is not to say that there is an integrated Western culture or a fixed Western identity or a single Western way of thinking, but that a singular collective identity defines itself in terms of a unique historicity in contrast to all others. A historicity that shifts from place to place, Greece, Rome, Latin Christendom, the Americas, until it embraces the world. It was in Europe's 18th century that the older Christian attitudes toward historical time, salvational expectation, were combined with the newer secular practices, rational prediction, to give us our modern idea of progress. A new philosophy of agency was also developed, allowing individual actions to be related to collective tendencies. From the Enlightenment philosophies, through the Victorian evolutionist thinkers, to the experts on economic and political development in the latter half of the 20th century, one assumption has been constant. To make history, the agent must create the future, remake himself, and help others to do so, where the criteria of successful remaking are seen to be universal. Old universes must be subverted and a new universe created. To that extent, history can be made only on the back of a universal teleology. Action seeking to maintain the local status quo or to follow local models of social life do not qualify as history making. From the cargo cults of Melanesia to the Islamic Revolution in Iran, they merely attempt, hopelessly, to resist the future or to turn back the clock of history. Anthropology is thus inserted into modern history in two ways. First, through the growth of Europe's political, economic, and scientific powers, which has provided anthropologists with their means of professional existence and their intellectual motive. And second, through the Enlightenment schemization of progressive time that has provided anthropology with its conceptual site, modernity. It is not just that anthropology is a modern creation born out of Europe's encounter with non-Europeans. It is that the major ideas it uses to grasp its subjects, non-modern, local, traditional, are often dependent on its contrastive sense of the modern. Modern anthropology's theoretical focus on human diversity has its roots in Renaissance Europe's encounter with the savage. That brutal encounter in Africa and the New World produced disturbing theological problems for reflective Christians. How to explain the variety of human beings, given the Mosaic account of creation? This was the primary question that animated scholars who read the exotic descriptions by explorers, and the great range of religious belief and practice among other peoples was the primary object of their attention. It is often said that the Renaissance discovered man, but that discovery was an effect of psychological reconstruction of European individuality. The accounts of savages by explorers returning from Africa and the New World produced a very different phenomenon, a man whose kinship to Christian Europeans was highly problematic. Some writers even held that he was not quite human. The eventual solution, adopted in the late 17th and early 18th centuries, according to Margaret Hodgen, was a synthesis of two old ideas, the chain of being and the genetic principle. In this way, a spatial arrangement of forms was converted into an historical, developmental, or evolutionary series. A common human nature was thus accorded to all human beings, but one that was assumed to exist in various stages of maturity and enlightenment. A prehistoric period was added to the historical triad, the time of primitive man. And just as some contemporaneous local peoples could be assigned to the prehistoric period, others were placeable in the medieval. The early preoccupation with saving the biblical story of man's creation and fall gave way to a new concern with narrating the secular story of European world hegemony in developmental terms. As a result of developments in higher criticism, a problem of Christian theology has virtually evaporated, but some of the ideas generated to address it remain in secular disciplines, formed in pursuit of a new universality. Of course, significant mutations have occurred in the historical schemata for classifying and explaining human diversity during the 18th, 19th, and 20th centuries, but there have been continuities too, including historical periodization and direction. Another continuity, as George Stocking notes, was the assumption of a single human nature underlying cultural plurality. In practice, however, anthropology and Orientalism, between them, dealt conceptually with existing local peoples left behind in the progressive evolution of modern European civilization, while a number of specialist disciplines dealt with the latter. In this way, the idea of a single nature for all humans appeared to concede that some are evidently more mature than others. It has become a truism to say that most anthropologists in Britain and the United States were anti-evolutionist and therefore relativist in the first half of the 20th century. Some historians of the discipline have connected this to the general mood of disillusion with the idea of progress prevailing in the West after World War I. This view is not entirely accurate, however, at any rate for British social anthropology. Neither Malinowski nor Radcliffe Brown rejected the idea of higher and lower cultures and of the upward development of the latter. Godfrey and Monica Wilson saw no difficulty in presenting the evolution of relations and ideas in Africa from primitive to civilized, nor did Max Gluckman in depicting the adoption of white culture by Africans as progressive. Lucy Mayer spoke unapologetically of the effects of European colonial rule in Africa as the spread of civilization, and Mary Douglas reaffirmed the importance of an evolutionary perspective. So too, some in ways more explicit and others in ways less so, did the scores of anthropologists who attended to problems of particular social change in the non-Western world. Their lack of interest in tracing the development of culture as a human universal and their attachment to the idea of social systems in temporary equilibrium did not mean the rejection of progressive evolution in every form. Indeed, it could be argued that there was less concern with demonstrating the principle of common human nature and more with describing normal historical developments in various parts of the non-European world. The major point, at any rate, is that whether they were concerned with customary beliefs and practices or with contemporary social and cultural changes, anthropologists saw themselves and were seen by others as dealing typically with non-modern lives. Certainly, if anthropology was expected to deal with political, economic, religious, legal, medical, poetic, and historical events, It was only when these objects of modern disciplines were situated in a non-modern social totality. Like other modern writers on the non-modern world, anthropologists used a dual modality of historical time, which enabled them to represent events as at once contemporaneous and non-contemporaneous, and thus some conditions as more progressive than others. It has been said that this focus has made anthropology a marginal discipline in comparison to those that deal with modern civilization itself, culturally marginal to its own society as well as to the groups that were the subject of ethnographic fieldwork. The rejection of anthropology by westernizing elites in former colonial countries is well known, and the reasons for it are not hard to understand. But the assumption that anthropology is culturally marginal to modern European society needs to be re-examined. It is true that anthropological theories have contributed very little to the formation of theories in politics, economics, and other social sciences. And yet, paradoxically, aspects of anthropology's discourse on the non-modern, those addressing the primitive, the irrational, the mythic, the traditional, have been of central importance to several disciplines. Thus, psychoanalysis, theological modernism, and modernist literature, among others, have continually turned for support to anthropology in their attempts to probe, accommodate, celebrate, or qualify the essence of modernity. Anthropology, then, appears to be involved in definitions of the West, while Western projects are transforming the preliterate, pre-capitalist, pre-modern peoples that ethnographers claim to represent. Both processes need to be studied systematically. To understand better the local peoples entering or resisting modernity, anthropology must surely try to deepen its understanding of the West as something more than a threadbare ideology. To do that will include attempting to grasp its peculiar historicity, the mobile powers that have constructed its structures, projects, and desires. I argue that religion, in its positive and negative senses, is an essential part of that construction. The following chapters engage with fragments of Western history approached as genealogies, archaisms, translations, and polemics. They are intended as a contribution to a historical anthropology that takes the cultural hegemony of the West as its object of inquiry. More precisely, they explore ways in which Western concepts and practices of religion define forms of history making. Genealogies. 1. The construction of religion as an anthropological category. In much 19th century evolutionary thought, religion was considered to be an early human condition from which modern law, science, and politics emerged and became detached. In this century, most anthropologists have abandoned Victorian evolutionary ideas, and many have challenged the rationalist notion that religion is simply a primitive and therefore outmoded form of the institutions we now encounter in truer form, law, politics, science, in modern life. For these 20th century anthropologists, religion is not an archaic mode of scientific thinking, nor of any other secular endeavor we value today. It is, on the contrary, a distinctive space of human practice and belief, which cannot be reduced to any other. From this, it seems to follow that the essence of religion is not to be confused with, say, the essence of politics, although in many societies, the two may overlap and be intertwined. In a characteristically subtle passage, Louis Dumont has told us that medieval Christendom was one such composite society. I shall take it for granted that a change in relations entails a change in whatever is related. If throughout our history, religion has developed to a large extent with some other influences at play, a revolution in social values, and has given birth by sissiparity, as it were, to an autonomous world of political institutions and speculations, then surely religion itself will have changed in the process. Of some important and visible changes, we are all aware, but I submit we are not aware of the change in the very nature of religion as lived by any given individual, say a Catholic. Everyone knows that religion was formerly a matter of the group and has become a matter of the individual, in principle, and in practice, at least in many environments and situations. But if we go on to assert that this change is correlated with the birth of the modern state, the proposition is not such a commonplace as the previous one. Let us go a little further. Medieval religion was a great cloak. I am thinking of the mantle of Our Lady of Mercy. Once it became an individual affair, it lost its all-embracing capacity and became one among other apparently equal considerations, of which the political was the firstborn. Each individual may, of course, and perhaps even will, recognize religion or philosophy as the same all-embracing consideration as it used to be socially. Yet, on the level of social consensus or ideology, the same person will switch to a different configuration of values in which autonomous values, religious, political, etc., are seemingly juxtaposed, much as individuals are juxtaposed in society. According to this view, medieval religion, pervading or encompassing other categories, is nevertheless analytically identifiable. It is this fact that makes it possible to say that religion has the same essence today as it had in the Middle Ages, although its social extension and function were different in the two epochs. Yet, the insistence that religion has an autonomous essence, not to be confused with the essence of science or of politics or of common sense, invites us to define religion, like any essence, as a transhistorical and transcultural phenomenon. It may be a happy accident that this effort of defining religion converges with the liberal demand in our time that it be kept quite separate from politics, law, and science, spaces in which varieties of power and reason articulate our distinctively modern life. This definition is at once part of a strategy for secular liberals of the confinement and for liberal Christians in the defense of religion. Yet, this separation of religion from power is a modern Western norm, the product of a unique post-Reformation history. The attempt to understand Muslim traditions by insisting that in them religion and politics, two essences modern society tries to keep conceptually and practically apart, are coupled, must, in my view, lead to failure. At its most dubious, such attempts encourage us to take up an a priori position in which religious discourse in the political arena is seen as a disguise for political power. And what follows, I want to examine the ways in which the theoretical search for an essence of religion invites us to separate it conceptually from the domain of power. I shall do this by exploring a universalist definition of religion offered by an eminent anthropologist, Clifford Geertz's Religion as a Cultural System. I stress that this is not primarily a critical view of Geertz's ideas on religion. If that had been my aim, I would have addressed myself to the entire corpus of his writings on religion in Indonesia and Morocco. My intention in this chapter is to try to identify some of the historical shifts that have produced our concept of religion as the concept of transhistorical essence, and Geertz's article is merely my starting point. It is part of my basic argument that socially identifiable forms, preconditions, and effects of what was regarded as religion in the medieval Christian epoch were quite different from those so considered in modern society. I want to get at this well-known fact while trying to avoid a simple nominalism. What we call religious power was differently distributed and had a different thrust. There were different ways in which it created and worked through legal institutions, different selves that it shaped and responded to, and different categories of knowledge which it authorized and made available. Nevertheless, what the anthropologist is confronted with as a consequence is not merely an arbitrary collection of elements and processes that we happen to call religion, for the entire phenomenon is to be seen in large measure in the context of Christian attempts to achieve a coherence in doctrines and practices, rules and regulations, even if that was a state never fully attained. My argument is that there cannot be a universal definition of religion, not only because its constituent elements and relationships are historically specific, but because that definition is itself the historical product of discursive processes. A universal, that is, anthropological definition is, however, precisely what Geertz aims at. A religion, he proposes, is 1. A system of symbols which act to 2. Establish powerful, pervasive, and long-lasting moods and motivations in men by 3. Formulating conceptions of a general order of existence and 4. Clothing these conceptions with such an aura of factuality that 5. The moods and motivations seem uniquely realistic. In what follows, I shall examine this definition, not only in order to test its interlinked assertions, but also to flesh out the counterclaim that a transhistorical definition of religion is not viable. The concept of symbol as a clue to the essence of religion. Geertz sees his first task as the definition of symbol, any object, act, event, quality, or relation which serves as a vehicle for a conception. The conception is the symbol's meaning. But this simple, clear statement, in which symbol, any object, etc., is differentiated from, but linked to, conception, its meaning, is later supplemented by others not entirely consistent with it. For it turns out that the symbol is not an object that serves as a vehicle for a conception. It is itself the conception. Thus, in the statement, the number 6, written, imagined, laid out as a row of stones, or even punched into the program tapes of sensations as versions of the same symbol, the number 6, is of course a conception. Furthermore, Geertz sometimes seems to suggest that even as a conception, a symbol has an intrinsic connection with empirical events from which it is merely theoretically separable. The symbolic dimension of social events is, like the psychological, itself theoretically abstractable from these events as empirical totality. At other times, however, he stresses the importance of keeping symbols and empirical objects quite separate. There is something to be said for not confusing our traffic with symbols, with our traffic with objects or human beings, for these latter are not in themselves symbols, however often they may function as such. Thus, symbol is sometimes an aspect of reality, sometimes of its representation. These divergences are symptoms of the fact that cognitive questions are mixed up in this account with communicative ones, and this makes it difficult to inquire into the ways in which discourse and understanding are connected in social practice. To begin with, we might say, as a number of writers have done, that a symbol is not an object or event that serves to carry a meaning, but a set of relationships between objects or events uniquely brought together as complexes or as concepts, having at once an intellectual, instrumental, and emotional significance. If we define symbol along these lines, a number of questions can be raised about the conditions that explain how such complexes and concepts come to be formed, and in particular, how their formation is related to varieties of practice. Half a century ago, Vygotsky was able to show how the development of children's intellect is dependent on the internalization of social speech. This means that the formation of what we have here called symbols, complexes, concepts, is conditioned by the social relations in which the growing child is involved, by the social activities that he or she is permitted or encouraged or obliged to undertake, in which other symbols, speech, and significant movements are crucial. The conditions, discursive and non-discursive, that explain how symbols come to be constructed, and how some of them are established as natural or authoritative, as opposed to others, then become an important object of anthropological inquiry. It must be stressed that this is not a matter of urging the study of the origin and function of symbols in addition to their meaning. Such a distinction is not relevant here. What is being argued is that the authoritative status of representations/discourses is dependent on the appropriate production of other representations/discourses. The two are intrinsically and not just temporally connected. Systems of symbols, says Geertz, are also culture patterns, and they constitute extrinsic sources of information. Extrinsic because They lie outside the boundaries of the individual organism, as such in that intersubjective world of common understandings into which all human individuals are born. And sources of information in the sense.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.